Namaskaram. My name is Nisha Rajagopalan and I'm a Carnatic vocalist. Before I begin, I would just like to say that I'm so excited to be a part of this brilliant initiative, Abhyasam, by Padma Bhushan awardee, Sangeeta Kananidhi, Srimati Sudha Raghunathan. This is really a boon to students of music to get access to the learning paths and practice methods of so many musicians. And I'm truly humbled that she invited me to be a part of this as well. Thank you so much, Sudha Akka. I've been performing concerts for around the last 20 years, and I've been blessed to have had the opportunities to learn from some of the greatest gurus of Carnatic music. Growing up in Toronto, Canada, my initial training was from my mother, Srimati Vasundhara Rajagopal. Naturally, living under the same roof, training was not restricted only to my classes and practice sessions. My mother did ensure that I followed a strict regimen of classes, but there were also many unstructured elements or informal elements to my musical training. For instance, she would just be cooking something in the kitchen and she would say, "Okkanda edavadhu paadu." So I would just sit in the kitchen and sing whatever kriti or varnam or whatever manodharma, if I was working on something at the time, I would practice. When I was about 10 years old, the opportunity of a lifetime came my way. On a chance visit to the Pittsburgh Balaji Temple, we met Sri T.R. Subramaniam and found that he was teaching there for the summer. This was the beginning of my tutelage under him. My classes with T.R.S. Mama were very intense and lengthy sessions. It was a very new experience for me. He would insist that every swara, every anuswara was perfect, and he would not proceed with the kriti or even the sangati until he was satisfied. He also would insist on perfect shruti alignment. He would tell me to sing with abandon and lose myself in the music. He always used to say that I was too thin and I didn't have enough energy. And he would say that I should eat 16 chapatis. Nee 16 chapati saaptaadane nee kacheri panna mudiyo, nee eppadi kacheri panna pora appdin solluvar. And I still remember when he taught me O Jagadamba, the kriti in Anand Bhairavi. He joked that if I was to sing this in a kacheri, I would have to keep an oxygen cylinder next to me, because by the time I sang O, I would run out of energy and the concert would have to end. So he used to very jokingly and casually instill these ideas in my mind that breath control is very important, having sufficient energy to sustain a concert or a performance or even singing in general. He kind of instilled these principles in my mind in a very friendly manner. I also developed a love for Pallavis and T.R.S. Mama's mind-boggling Kanakaswarams. I would just go for class one day and he would say, "While eating tiffin today, I composed this Pallavi." And he would sing a brilliantly conceptualized Pallavi and immediately on the spot sing Neraval Trikalam. You name it, he would sing it. And then he would expect me also to try. Needless to say, there would be many slips and many mistakes before I could figure it out and get it right. But he would always encourage and gently help me to figure out where I had gone wrong. For mathematical complexities like Trikalam, for instance, he would give me small tips to make it easy for me to execute it. Like he would tell me while singing Trikalam to mark certain landmarks at the Thalam. If this word falls at this point on the Thalam, adha mark panni vechuko. Engayavadhu thappu pannenaka andha edathila inda correct panniko appdi solluvar. For example, just a simple Pallavi, which is a composition of T.R.S. Mama's.
Ranjani, Niranjani, Bhavabhanjani, Namami. Rasika jana manamohini, Ranjani, Niranjani, Bhavabhanjani, Namami.
So I'll just sing the male column for this. just to demonstrate.
Namami Rasika Jana Manamohini Ranjani Niranjani Bhavabhanjani Namami Rasika Jana Manamohini Ranjani Niranjani Bhavabhanjani Namami.
So he would say, and the Ranjani Tatla Varda, the Ranjani comes on the beat, so make a note of it. And he would say, if it doesn't come on the beat, start from there and adjust it so that when you finish, you will finish successfully and you will not go astray. So these were the kinds of ideas he would give to make something potentially complicated seem very simple and very easy to deal with. In my formative years itself, I came to think of Pallavis as something enjoyable to sing and not something to be worried about or stressed about. He would also stop in the middle of a kriti and say, Indadathukku vandu porthuma edavadhu swaram paada. And before I could even think twice, he would reel off three or four. So for example, the kriti Karpaga Manohara and Malaya Marutam.
Karpaga Manohara.
So I would just sing something like,
Gadababagari Karpaga Manohara.
And Mama would just smile and sing,
Nida nida taba daba pa karpaga manohara.
Or the charanam of Ramachandram Bhavayami in Vasanta Ragam.
Kakustam dhimantam kamalacham shrimantam.
Idhukku he would start singing and he would build on the same idea or thought that he had had in initially.
Magarisani sa sanida bhagava magarisani kakustam dhimantam. Magarisani sa 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 sanida bhagava magarisani kakustam dhimantam. Magarisani sa ma sanida bhagava vanini magarisani kakustam dhimantam.
And it would go on for any kriti that you could name. He would think of any number of these kinds of purutams or kanakas. After moving to Chennai, I came under the tutelage of Sri P.S. Narayana Swami. In the initial years of going for classes, it used to be just Amma and I. After getting acquainted better with my co-students, we used to have joint classes, joint practice sessions. And Mama would ask all of us to sit and he would say, Yenati nomoka naraval swaram padunga. So we would start a round robin of singing and Mama would also interject with some gems and we would have the opportunity to listen to the quick fire sparkling Kalpana Swarams that Semangudi Mama was famous for. Or even while teaching a Raga Alapana, or even if he asked us to sing it, he would suddenly start and before we knew it, he would have sung these breathtaking brigas that he was so well known for. Mama always used to say that a kriti has to be practiced 1,000 times before it can be presented on the stage. Now, I certainly cannot claim that I sing everything 1,000 times at home before I sing it in a concert. But I certainly do try to take any opportunity I can to internalize the kriti. Not necessarily just singing at home a full-blown practice session with tambura and all that. Anytime you can find me singing while cooking or while driving, I have gotten quite a few funny looks from other people sitting in other cars. So I try to maximize my time to practice the kritis to kind of live up to P.S. and Mama's ideal of that. I certainly do appreciate the value of repeated sadhakam for a kriti to be internalized completely. Learning from Sugana Varadachari Mami, I had the opportunity to observe her style of singing very closely. She was very particular that all the nuances of her music were imbibed by her students as well. Mami would patiently explain every minute intricacy of every kriti and she would make sure that we understood and absorbed the sophistication that was so inherent to her style. This ensured that every kriti we learned from her became imprinted on our minds. And to this day, any kriti I have learned from her, I remember it perfectly. Her approach to Nerval was very, very different to me. There were many rules that I was not familiar with. For instance, she would say that when singing Nerval, when you return to the line of the kriti after one round of Nerval, you should sing the kriti line only as it has been sung in the kriti and not change it. She would say that the placement of syllables in that line should be the same as it is in the kriti. And she would also insist that the Nerval should be appropriate to that kriti. So for example, if you take the kriti Sitapati in Kamas, composed by Tyagaraja Swami, he has not used the Kakali Nishadam at all in this kriti. So she would say, Andha Nerval paadrache Kakali Nishadam varakudadu, abdin solva.
Prema Joji Napai Pedda Manasu Jesi Prema Joji Napai Prema Joji Napai Pedda Manasu Jesi Prema Joji Napai Pedda Manasu Jesi Prema Joji Napai Prema Joji Napai Pedda Manasu Jesi Prema Joji Napai Pedda Manasu Jesi Prema Joji Napai
So on the
Prema Joji Joji Napai
That's a phrase which is inherent to Kamas but in the Kriti la vandaan solva. So in many ways my approach to practice today is an amalgam of what I have learned from my gurus as well as through my own personal experience. On any given day, my practice session might include my own humble attempts at some of TRS Mama's mind-boggling kanakas, some of PSN Mama's breakneck speed brigas, or some of Suguna Mami's soulful nervals, and so on and so forth. There are so many aspects of the music which I have been and continue to be inspired by. And it is really my ongoing endeavor to imbibe and organically absorb these into my own music. TRS Mama always used to say, to become a successful musician, the formula is 25% guru, 25% uru, that is memorizing and then internalizing, 25% listening, and 25% teaching. I've had some really wonderful opportunities to do listening sessions with both TRS Mama and PSN Mama. PSN Mama used to conduct listening sessions for all the students and we would discuss different aspects of the recordings of great masters that we listened to. And he would explain so many intricacies and make it easy for us to understand. TRS Mama used to actually take me with him when he went to attend concerts and afterwards he would discuss them with me. Both of these have really helped me to observe other musicians' renditions, concerts, and for me to get inspired by their ideas and to try and imbibe something of what I admire in my own music. So these kinds of things, for example, if I attend a concert today and I hear something that really touches me, I might try to emulate the same in my own practice sessions in the coming days. Now, as a teacher with my own students, we, apart from teaching kritis or manodharma or whatever it is, we do discuss other musicians' renditions. We discuss their approach to a kriti, their approach to manodharma. We discuss even concert planning, why certain things work for certain musicians, why they work in certain concerts. And there are so many aspects, the list is endless. And I find that I learn so much more when I'm teaching as well. My own personal practice sessions differ on a day-to-day basis. For example, during the music season with back-to-back performances, I may not sit down and have a full-throated practice session. I may just run through kritis in my mind, revise lyrics or listen to the great masters' renditions to get inspired by them or in the hope of being inspired by them. On a normal day, I do start my practice sessions with some kind of a warm-up. Sometimes it could be a varnam in two or three speeds, or I sing a varnam in different nadais, Trisala nada or Khanda nada, in the hope of warming up my brain a little. So for example, I might try singing a varnam in Kirkalam and Melkalam Tisram.
Ninnu ko aari yunnara, ninnu ko aari yunnara.
So these kinds of exercises, I found that personally my voice takes longer to warm up in the lower octaves. So for me, practicing the Bhairavi Swarajati on a regular basis helps me coax my voice into cooperation. The gradual progression of the Swara Sahitya from the lower Shajjam to the upper Shajjam is a beautiful way to kind of gently warm up your voice, and I found that it personally soothes me as well.
Anudinamo maravagane nee padamula dekano jo nammite nee shri kanchika ma che amba sari ni sari ni re sa ni da pa ma pa da ni ga ri ka ga ma chi om ma.
And so on and so forth. So by the time I reach the last Swara Sahitya, I find that my voice is quite well warmed up. I don't often get time to do such things nowadays, but in earlier, less busy times, I used to take unusual ragas and practice all the basic exercises in them. So all the Sarali Varsas, Janta Varsas, Dhatu Varsay, Aprasthai Varsay, everything. And I find that trying these basic exercises in such ragams, which are new to me, helps me fix the swarasthanas and also gives ideas for possibilities for manodharma later, swaram singing, etc. For example, a ragam like Vakula Bharanam.
Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa, sa ni da pa ma ga re sa. Sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga re sa. Sa re sa re sa re ga ma sa re ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni sa ni sa ni da pa sa ni da pa ma ga re sa.
So the same thing, trying in different speeds, trying in akara, all these things are very helpful as practice methods. And trying to sing Kalpana Swarams with small bits of inspiration from the Varisais is also something I enjoy trying out.
Ye Ramuni Nammiti Ennu Samaga Mariga Sarere Pabaga Mariga Gada Pada Pabaga Mada Pabaga Mama Gerizani Ye Ramuni.
So this was kind of a take on
samaga mare ga sare sa ga re ga sare ga mare pa ma ma ga mare ga re ma ga mare ga ma pa ga da ba da ma pa ga ma ga pa ma pa ga ma pa da.
So these are small things which we can try out at home, and hopefully inspiration also strikes on the stage. Even today, when handling a new ragam, if I find that I'm not able to sing the ragam effectively, I find that going back to these exercises is very helpful. Of course, the guru's guidance is the number one factor here. Beyond that, listening to kritis in that ragam, listening to other artists, great masters' renditions of these ragams, and trying to find apt phrases in that ragam. For example, the Vakula Bharanam that we saw earlier, it can very easily become a ragam which is just a jumble of Maya Mala Gola and Todi. So to circumvent this, I try to take inspiration from my gurus, from listening and from my own exploration with these different exercises. Another aspect which these basic exercises has helped me with greatly is in the singing of faster sangatis or rikas. This never used to come naturally to me. And what I used to do is, I used to take the Sarali Varsa and I used to sing it in slow speed and try and build it up bit by bit, until I was singing it as fast as I possibly could. And this helped me a lot while trying to develop my Riga singing. So, for example, just the Sarali Varsas, just the first one. So, singing the same exercise in different speeds, pushing yourself to sing just a little faster every time. These are things which I've used to develop my Riga singing skills, and it becomes more complicated as you take the more complicated exercises. So those things are really helpful. These are things which I do include in my practice sessions from time to time. Another useful way to simultaneously practice, warm up and work on your Shruti Shuddham is very, very simple. Take a ragam, even something like Shankarabharanam, which is familiar to all of us, and hold each note as long as you can and as perfectly as you can align to the Shruti. And so on and so forth. This is just a small sample. Pranayama is something that has helped me immensely, as breath control is always something that I've wanted to improve. I find that it's also a huge help when I have a cold and I need to clear out my airways just before a concert. I would not really want to demonstrate, leave alone guide anyone in this, but I would rather urge those who are interested to take the guidance of a qualified instructor. They would be able to help with appropriate exercises. The same goes for yoga. Yoga is a very scientific and complex practice which strengthens the mind and the body. And there's absolutely no doubt that practicing yoga on a regular basis calms our mind and enables us to physically and mentally withstand the rigors of singing and performing. So although I do include these two as part of my own regimen, I would not want to specifically share any exercises, as they are highly individualistic and should be taught by someone who is trained to do so. Last but not the least, food. I am a huge foodie, and luckily for me, I don't have any major food sensitivities, so I've been really blessed on that front. In general, I prefer to eat non-oily and healthy food, so I don't have to place many restrictions on myself. The odd time I do have a craving for chole bature or something, and if I have a concert coming up, I try to hold back and then maybe indulge after the performance. I do have a sweet tooth, which I try to keep in check, sometimes with success, sometimes with not so much. The one area in which I'm very strict with myself is with cold beverages. 99% of the time, I don't touch them. Before a concert, I won't even go near them. I drink plenty of water on a daily basis, and I find that drinking turmeric water is very helpful, especially when I have a bit of a scratchy throat. My mother makes this magical concoction, which she calls golden elixir, which has many herbs and roots in it, including a healthy dose of turmeric. It's excellent for respiratory health, general immunity. So I start my day with this in hot water. So this is pretty much about my diet. I do indulge. I'm not a complete health nut. I do indulge the odd day, but I try to restrict it when I have performances coming up. So these are some of the things I wanted to share about my music and my various related regimens. Once again, I would like to thank Sudha Akka for inviting me to be a part of this wonderful project. I'm sure many other musicians would have valuable tips to share, and I look forward to seeing them as well. Thank you so much once again, and namaskaram.